Shall we start?
Yes, of course.
So today's speaker is Konstantinos, Theofilatos, and he's going to speak about bioinformatic analysis of large data sets.
Hello, thank you very much, Sylvia. I'm Konstantinos Theofilatos. I'm a lecturer in bioinformatics, and I'm going to present you about bioinformatics analysis of large omics datasets, starting from statistical analysis and going forward to pathway region analysis and network analytics. So the content of this workshop will start with basic principles of statistical processing, walk through the basic graphs that we are using to interpret omics data, functional pathway enrichment analysis, biological process networks with a lot of emphasis on protein interaction networks and how we process them to identify clusters and visualize them. And finally, we'll conclude with a case study for the analysis of omics data from atherosclerotic plaques, which will summarize some of the above steps and give some practical examples about how they have been used to process a high throughput omics data set and get some biological conclusions from it. So we're going to start with statistical processing because this is the first step that we apply when we get a new data set to explore whether there exist markers, proteins, transcripts, or whatever we're quantifying every time that is differentiated significantly between the conditions we're examining. Let it be different time points or different conditions before and after the treatment, or control versus diseases, or a combination of these. However, when you have to perform statistical processing, there are many things someone has to consider in order to get the most informed decisions about the methods that should be used, as well as the parameters and the different pipelines of analysis that should be followed. Something that, to begin with, someone should consider how the data should be optimized and how the processing of the data should be optimized before applying statistics in order to make them more suitable to have the maximum power, statistical power from the test that we apply. I'm going to tell you some more details later on this. But the next thing we want to decide is what is the most suitable statistical test based on the conditions of our dataset and on the type of our dataset. Next, we have to decide what covariates to correct for. As covariates, it can be some demographics like age, some medications like specific medications which might affect the biomarkers examined in our dataset, or even some technical covariates like the batch that the experiment has been run on, the date or the technician, in order to remove any potential technical bias that lies in our data. And finally, we need always to apply corrections for multiple testing and avoid, and this might lead us to some positions and situations where we might get trapped of having very few transcripts or proteins being differentially expressed when correcting for multiple testing. And we can see how we can walk around this problem and use our data efficiently without compromising, of course, the quality and inducing bias. So this is a very simple decision tree we have put together for processing omics data. The first step of this is data-specific pre-processing. And this may involve, for example, normalizing when it comes to proteomics data based on a reference channel when it is labeled proteomics, or it may involve calculating the RPKM and FPKM from the raw reads of an RNA sequencing experiments and all the different processing that we should perform in the raw data until we get a tabularized format of data without excluding as many biases as possible from it. Next, an additional step that we apply for this before applying statistics is to logarithmize the data. And this is a very important step because there are many theorems that support that logarithmizing the data makes them to be as closer to the normal distribution, thus allowing us most times to apply parametric testing. Then there's an optional step here that someone can apply, which is the data filtering to remove outliers. This can be done by exploring, by simply exploring the heat maps of the data and applying some bi-clustering, and we'll see some examples later on, or by correlating them to, let's say, if we have clinical variables, that clinical measurements of some of the proteins, we can correlate with them and identify biomarkers, and there are outliers, and there are many techniques that could be used here to remove outliers. However, someone should be cautious in removing outliers in order to avoid removing samples that have to do are distant to the others because of some biological reason and because of biological variability. Then another step is data filtering based on missing values. This is a very complex concept, and there exist many methods and tools to deal with missing values. In many of the papers, you will be seeing that researchers either exclude all the samples with missing values in order to make them applicable and to be able to analyze them with simple statistics offered by web tools, or they use zeros in all the missing values, which is not correct in most cases, because missing values does not mean, for example, low expression of an RNA or of a protein per se, but it might mean that something went wrong for this experiment and we have not got the value, but it's not a low expression value. So something that we do before we perform any analysis is to remove the features, the variables, proteins or transcripts, based on a predefined threshold that we set for missing values. So you would see in papers that many are using 50% up to 20% to filter out variables with too many missing values. But even if we remove this, we still end up with some remaining missing values. And again, there are many techniques that could be used to impute them and use some values in the empty ones. This can be done by adding zeros in consistent missing values that we have some evidence that they mean that there was a very low expression there or an expression below the limit of detection, or other techniques like KNN or even machine learning models like SVMs can be used to predict the remaining missing values. After we have done this, we have a complete table of data with variables and samples, and someone can correct for any covariates that he might be interested in, using, for example, linear regression models with the LIMA tool or any other available solution for this. But we should be cautious when we correcting for covariates, not to exclude any biological meaningful information by overcorrecting. And it is always good to do the analysis more than once without correcting, and correcting with basic variables while collecting with more elaborate combinations of covariates. And after we have done also this analysis, then there is the turn of applying a normality test. There exist many normality tests that could be applied that could tell us whether our data follow normal distribution and whether we can use parametric or non-parametric testing. If we end up not having normally distributed variables or we have less than 5 samples per group, we should go for parametric testing. In this case, when we have less than 5 samples, We cannot use non-parametric methods because for none of the comparisons will become significant. So we have to make a compromise and tell that even if our data are non-parametric, we should use a parametric test because this is what we can do. And this is very usual for small animal studies where someone has conducted a pilot study of 3 versus 3 or 4 versus 4. In these cases, we cannot do anything more than a simple parametric test, and this is what we do. But again, we know that we violate the exceptions of and the conditions of the test. And this is why we cannot claim that we found statistically significant changes. But on the other hand, we can use these p-values that we calculate to prioritize the variables we explore and identify which are the most importantly significantly changing. Next, we have to answer this questionnaire in order to end up with a non-parametric analysis. If we have two conditions to compare, then we use Mann-Whitney. If we have two conditions but are paired, we have to use Wilcoxon-Shine rank test. And if we have repeated measurements and two or more conditions, then we can use Friedman or mixed effects models combined with Mann-Whitney for the paired analysis. And if we have repeated measurements, we can use a combination of Kuskal-Wallis with Wilcoxon-Shine rank tests. And finally, when we got more than two conditions, we can again use Kuskal-Wallis combined with Mann-Whitney test. The selection between Friedman and mixed effect models here could be done based on the fact of whether we have any missing repeated measures. In this case, we have to use a mixed effect model, which can handle missingness in the repeat measures. But it is nowadays a trend to use mixed effect models because they are more powerful to compare to Friedman or ANOVA in all cases. So you might see in the literature most of the papers that are dealing with this situation, they are nowadays using mixed effect models. And after we have done this, then we need to correct for multiple testing, with the preferred solution being now the FTR adjustment with the Benzamini-Hochberg method. If in this position we have found a normality or less than 5 samples, then we go and do the analysis shown in the next slide, which is the equivalent methods, but just using the parametric ones. Instead of Mann-Whitney or Wilcoxon, we now use t-tests, and instead of Friedman or Kruskal-Wallis analysis, we use 2 or 1-way ANOVAs or mixed effect models again in this case. While for the pairwise comparisons, it is always good to apply the TACI adjustments to allow for the corrections of the p-values based on the fact that we are making more than one paired comparisons. But again, this is a very rough image that can be used by beginners and in the field of statistical analysis to make some good decisions. There are many statistical tests out there that exceed these two slides. But this is a very simple pipeline to avoid doing very basic mistakes. However, even if we do this, in most of our studies in the labs, we end up having some hundreds of samples in a good case, or some tens in the bad case. But using high throughput technologies like metabolomics, proteomics, and transcriptomics, we can quantify 20,000 or 30,000 variables and even more. And someone might end up in a situation where most of the significant changes are being lost because of correcting for multiple testing and because of not having adequate number of samples to end up with a very low nominal p-value, which will survive the correction for multiple testing. However, we should not be discouraged by these situations, and there are ways to circumvent these problems. One method is to use the nominal p-values. They, even if by themselves they cannot prove statistical significant, they can always be used to rank the proteins or transcripts into the ones that are most interesting from us, the most close to statistical significance, and use them to identify significant findings, which we could then go and validate into first, either conducting targeted omics analysis with this small subset of variables, thus having a smaller effect of multiple testing comparison, and also validating the high throughput technique with a targeted technique. But another way is to also validate these findings against external cohorts or other published datasets. A second route that we can follow when we have an underpowered study is to use this study to perform power calculations and identify which would be the adequate sample size which can prove statistical significance for the identified changes in the markers and the proteins or transcripts we are examining every time. And then we can use this information to design new experiments for the additional samples or get funding or using an application of ours to get funding for the new experiments, which we can do and get the power we need to prove the statistical significant change. However, it might always be the case that we might end up with no significant changes, and this might be the actual case, and we might have actually a negative finding from a study like this. So the tools that we have to do this analysis, some of them are here, with starting with SPSS, which is a very simple commercial solution, but at King's we do have a license to use. However, it's a very simple tool for beginners to be able to use it with a very user-friendly interface, which is very well documented. And it also, but it doesn't allow us too many analysis options, cannot be used to, for example, implement the pipeline that I showed you before with the pre-processing steps, outlier detection, and all of this. But it is a very good initial step for someone to begin doing statistics on himself, because it has a very small learning curve. Then there is the PRISM tool from GraphPad, which again we do have a license in King's College, and it's a very nice tool not only for statistical analysis, because it also helps you with some questions, it poses you through the process to identify the correct test to be used, but it is also a very good tool for visualizing the data, because it has very high degrees of freedom into playing with colors and with fonts and so on. Then there is Perseus tool, which is a tool that was initially applied and used for processing proteomics, but it can be used for other types of omics data. And it gives you a bit more functionalities than the previous ones, but on the other side, it is more complex and it has a bigger learning curve. And for experienced programmers or even beginners, you can use scripting languages like R and Python. There are many packages always already implemented that can be used for this analysis. Now we're going to go through very fast the basic graphs to interpret data. You are aware of most of them, but I'm going to go through them. We start with the basic volcano plot, which actually is being used to show us two things. First, the log twofold change, but also the statistical significance. In most cases, we set up two thresholds. One could be based on the p-value, which is a threshold on the y-axis, and one which is a threshold based on the absolute log twofold change, which are two vertical lines in the x-axis. We can see here that the proteins that or transcripts that are in this part of the volcano plot, they are overexpressed in the one condition, and the one that are here are overexpressed in the other condition in the comparison we are making. And the more close to the top left and top right corner of this figure, the more significant the change. We can see from this type of figures that if we end up having, for example, a protein being very close to zero but significant, this might be because of, and this might be explained, for example, because of too low biological variability. And this can be the case for that we can identify as having only, for example, technical replicates in a small study without a lot of variability in the data. We want ideally to have as distant as possible here in these two areas to be able to infer something that is statistically significant from a volcano plot. However, volcano plots give a very big overview of our comparison. And if we want to examine specifically how, for a specific marker, the two different conditions or more conditions are changing, then we use box plots. And these are the very basic two different types of box plots. There exist many more. The category is called notch plots, which are showing us some more information from the statistical point of view, depicting with red lines here the medians, with this triangle here showing the 95% confidence interval of the median, with the black rectangle here, all this shows the 25 percentile and 75 percentile thresholds. And these are the markers that show a potential outlier. This is a very good plot here because it allows us, by just looking at it, to say whether this is a statistically significant change or not. If the two different triangles here are not overlapping, then we have a p-value less than 0.05. So this is the advantage of using notch plots, is that they are giving us visually all the results of the statistics. On the other side, plots like bean plots or other types of similar plots that you can nowadays see in the papers, because it is a priority to of the journals to visualize all the independent samples. The advantage of these plots is that we see every different sample. We see the medians with these lines here, and we also see the distribution of the samples shown by these figures that are generated here. But we cannot tell whether the difference is significant or not. So it gives us some additional information, but we lose some information from the notch plot. Then we have the heat maps. I'm sure every one of you have generated the heat map. A heat map is a very good way to get an overview of a complete data set and identify significant protein changes or transcript changes. By performing the biclustering method with hierarchical clustering or any of the alternatives of hierarchical clustering, we can identify sample or omics variables which are probably outliers. This can be done by, for example, seeing the clustering of the samples. And if we have two groups, let's say control and diseases, and a control is within the diseases, we should always go back and ask our technician whether something might have happened or a mislabeling or something that end up having this problem, or whether we should exclude this as outlier or not. But also heat maps are good because they can show give us a very quick way to identify functional groups of omics variables which might perform a biological function or might participate or be enriched in a pathway and so on. And finally, we can always identify clinically relevant clusters, let's say a subgroup of disease which is linked with worst outcome and so on. Then it is the PCA analysis. You can see it in 2D or 3D. PCA actually help us. It is a dimensionality reduction technique which allow us to combine all the different high throughput techniques into vertical components. We cannot, of course, visualize all the PCAs. Most of the times we calculate the PCAs that explain more than 90 or 95% of the variability of the data, but we can visualize only up to three of them. And they can be used to perform clustering based on this, but also to allow us to make an interpretation about which are the proteins or transcripts contributing most to each one of the PCAs, and thus explaining the overall variability of our data. And we can apply PCA analysis both to visualize samples as well as features. So in order to generate these graphs, you can either use Prism or Perseus that we saw before, or use another tool like MERV, which and specifically standalone version, which gives a lot of options for generating these figures, or generate your own R or Python scripts to have more custom-based figures. So when we have ended up with a subset of the features we have measured that might be related with the phenotypic difference we're exploring, then we could perform functionally and pathway enrichment analysis to see if this group of proteins or transcripts is enriched for a specific pathway or a functional term. And there exist two main statistical methods to do it: Fisher exact test and hypergeometric distribution, with their main difference not playing a significant role for high throughput omics, and using one or the other will probably most likely give you the same results or equal or similar results. Both of these methods are based on comparing the frequency of a term in a given list compared to the frequency of this term on, against the background, with the background being either the total number of proteins or transcripts that we can quantify from our experiment, or the complete proteome or transcriptome of an organism. And the simple tool to perform this analysis is David, with the basic advantage of David being that it is in sync with the databases like KEG or Genontology, meaning that when they get updated, David updates its own database, and you can always be up to date for when performing this analysis. What we do with David is we provide a list of proteins or transcripts or genes. We select the identifier type. We say that it is a gene list, and we can also upload a background or use as a background the organism, the complete proteome or transcriptome of the organism. And when we have applied, we uploaded the list, we can see how many of the markers have been identified. We can always select the organism of them if they are included in more than one organism. And we can select the number of the terms we want to include in our analysis from a combination of databases. When we press up the functional annotation chart, we can see a figure like this, which shows us the category of the term, the fold enrichment can be shown, the p-value, as well as additional columns, including the FTR corrected p-value and so on. The David tool is using the E-score, which is actually an expansion of the test we saw here, the Fisher exact test. But supposing that if knee proteins are characterized with a functional term, then it uses n minus 1 for the p-value calculations, supposing that we are starting with a protein and exploring whether the other n minus 1 are enriched with this protein as a group for a term. It's a more conservative approach and it gives reliable results, and this is why the E-score has prevailed in this type of analysis, but there exist other alternatives to do the same analysis. Some issues we need to consider when we are doing enrichment analysis is that someone does not have to have defined a perfect set of proteins. So even if we do have some false positives in our list or some false negatives, this will give us a rough estimation about which pathways or transcripts or functions are enriched in this group of markers. And it does not have to be a complete list to allow us to get these conclusions. Something that we could do to improve the results of enrichment analysis is to filter out proteins or transcripts that have not been functionally characterized at all. And this is something that you can see through David, for example, for when we include a marker which is not in the database, it is being excluded from the list. But if there is a specific protein without any prior knowledge of functional information, it is not excluded if it exists in the databases. But we should manually exclude a few of these proteins or transcripts to be able to get more enriched terms and have more correct analysis. And now we're going to discuss about what is the difference from pathway enrichment analysis to searching the pathways that each protein or gene is involved. So we can always go, if we have a gene or a protein, and search them in the database and see which are the functionalities they are doing. But the pathway or functional enrichment analysis is not equivalent to this. It tells us, in addition, not what a single gene or protein is doing, but what this group of genes or proteins are probably doing in terms of pathways, participation, or functional terms. And here are some other tools to perform functional pathway enrichment analysis. One of it is StringDB, with a disadvantage of not being able to offer to define a specific background, a custom background, and it only uses a complete organism background. We can always use Gorilla, which gives us also an ontology representation of the functional terms. Reactome to a specific analysis for the Reactome pathway database, and Metascape, which in addition to what we have mentioned here, offer us some network visualizations as well as disease-specific enrichment analysis in addition to the functional and pathway enrichment analysis. And now we're going to go into the analysis of biological networks. We know that protein transcripts and genes do not function standalone. So we are using protein networks to study the interactions between them and identify more complex mechanisms and that might happen in our data. And we're going to start with the description of the topological and other properties of biological networks, splitting them into two main categories: global network properties, which give us an overall view of the network, but might not be detailed enough to capture the complex topological characteristics of large networks, and also the local network properties, which give more detailed network description and usually encompass large number of constraints, reducing the degrees of freedom in which the networks being compared can vary. We use both these type of properties to get an overall view of our dataset and which are the important components of the network that we should study further, but also as quality control for the reconstructed network that we have from our data. So some global properties of networks are the degree distribution, the clustering coefficient, the between centrality, and the shortest paths. And we're going to see each one of them in more detail here. So the degree distribution, the degree of a node is the number of edges which are incident to the node. And the average degree of a network is the average of these degrees. So as a very brief overview of the connectivity of the network, how fully connected it is or how sparse it is. So using the degree metric, we can calculate the degree coefficient, which is actually the distribution of degrees and how frequent a degree is in the overall nodes. Biological networks are usually scale-free, which means that most nodes have low degree. So this is why we see a high frequency value here. And only a small number of nodes have high degree, and these are the hubs. The hubs are very important because they show that these are proteins or transcripts with too many interactions, performing more than one function in most cases and being very important for what we are studying every time. Then there is the clustering coefficient, which is a metric which allows us to see how fully connected, how close to the fully connected is a sub network compared to sparsely connected. So in these three examples here, clustering coefficient will be bigger in A, a bit smaller in B, and smallest in C. So if we get a network that has very high clustering coefficient, then it means that this could be clustered more easy. There are more easily defined clusters in our dataset compared to lower clustering coefficients. However, all these measures have the ability to identify hubs, both the degree and the clustering coefficient one, but they are not able to identify nodes which are important in a more global effect. So you can see here in this example that if we use the degree connectivity, then the B will, node will be the most important one because it has the most edges here. However, if we consider the A node here, we can see that many of the pathways in this network, most of the pathways in this network pass through A. So even if it has only two edges, it is very important because it interferes all of the pathways, and if something goes wrong, let's say a mutation or we have a knockout of this, then we'll have a massive effect on the network. So this is what it captures, the between centrality. It captures how many of the shortest paths pass through each one of the nodes. And the biological meaning of this is that it shows us how central the node is, not for its neighborhood, but for the global network. And we mentioned before shortest paths, and shortest paths are actually the minimum number of steps we can have to go from one node to another. And it is very important, again, when it comes to transcriptional networks, to be able to identify proteins who or transcripts who have a role into the transcription of another one, and so on. And then there are the network motifs we have, which are defined as subgraphs of the real network that are overrepresented when compared to partial subgraphs from random networks. And random networks can be generated by generating the edges between nodes with a probability. And the network motifs are very important because there are many publications existing that shows that specific motifs like cliques or triangles or fully connected components are very important for showing the underlying evolutionary processes, and also carry a lot of functional information that are linked with many specific functionalities. Now let's go and see the different subtypes of biological networks where we can apply all these metrics. Based on the information we show in the network, we can have different types of networks. We can either have only nodes and colors to show the functionalities of proteins or transcripts. When we add undirected edges, we can have a protein-protein interaction network, which tells us that A1 interacts with A2, with E2, but we don't know whether this, for example, regulates this, or this inhibits this, or something else. We don't just know that it interacts, or that it might interact. And we can have weights in the edges or not, showing the significance of the interaction or not. If we go and add the arrows in the edges, we can denote more detailed information about inhibition and activation. And we can even have isoforms of a protein like this to get the information of isoforms, or organize the network to also show topological information. Let's say these are cellular compartments. This shows us whether this protein could lie, and it could easily be used to identify cell-to-cell interaction points. So using these definitions, we have the metabolic pathways and the metabolomic networks, which are consisted of nodes being enzymes and substrates, and reactions that can be directional or bidirectional. And we can see here that this is the pathway of glycolysis. We have directed edges, and we have enzymes and substrates to participate in every of these interactions. And the most known database to get this information in these networks is the KEG database, which is a curated database for metabolic pathways. Another subtype is the gene regulatory networks, which is actually a directed network with two types of edges, inhibition and activation. And in order to generate this type of network, we either can use databases and previously constructed networks, or we should have access to time series data, which can be used to infer and model these interactions and identify whether something inhibits or activates something else. A more simple version of regulatory networks are the co-expression networks, for which we do not need time points in our analysis. And these networks can simply tell us whether two nodes are co-expressed in our dataset or not. And to reconstruct co-expression networks, because it's a very important tool when doing omics analysis, to reconstruct the expression networks and perform clustering and identify meaningful components of the network. This can be done by either using the simple Spearman or Pearson correlation, mutual information metrics. However, the disadvantage of them is that they don't end up with scale-free topologies. Thus, the networks reconstructed with them are not close to real biological networks and the distributions of them. And this is why there are other tools like the WGCNA, ArachneAP, and CoexNetVis, which have been designed to manually, to automatically set the thresholds and also exclude indirect links from the co-expression networks and get them a more close view of which are the actual co-expression network in our dataset. WGCNA is available in R, but also in several web tools. ArachneAP is available through an executable that can be used in Mac or Windows operating systems. And CoexNetVis is a web tool, which is the simplest of them, but the most naive approach of them, and the least accurate compared to WGCNA and ArachneAP, which are mostly used for this application. The next subcategory is the protein-protein interaction networks, which shows us as edges whether two proteins physically interact or indirectly interact based on what technique we have used to infer the edges. And finally, there exists the gene-to-disease networks, which connect genes and proteins to diseases and allow us to get an understanding about which are the diseases involved in biosignatures we have found. In summary, there exist different types of biological molecular networks which can be used to represent and be represented by different types of graphs. And networks can be created by either collecting interactions from papers or from databases, or reconstruct directly from the data. In general, we can use networks to integrate different big data sets using genes or proteins or combinations of them. So next, we're going to speak about PPI network, which is a specific category we discussed before, and methods to identify protein-protein interaction networks. There are two different subcategories, experimental subcategories. First, the small-scale biochemical assays, which can identify with very high accuracy but low throughput protein-protein interactions. And there are the high-throughput techniques, which like the yeast-to-hybrid technique or mass spectrometry-based techniques, which are able to identify a lot of interactions, but they possess a lot of high false positive rates, and they need to be filtered to end up with a real interactome. But for our sake, there exist many databases which we could use, and they are split into experimental ones, which the ones that include the interactions mined from experimental studies, and these are the blue ones here, and the ones that include in silico techniques to predict or score the interactions, like the ones that are represented with the yellow color here. And this is one of the most commonly used string database, which takes as input a list of proteins or genes and reconstruct the protein-protein interaction network, showing with different colors here the edges, the evidence we have for each interaction. And we can always get these networks from databases or the ones that we have reconstructed them and use the Cytoscape tool to get network figures and also include in these networks results of the statistical analysis or other annotations we have for the proteins or transcripts, and perform also analytics like clustering and more analysis of these networks to get more conclusions, or even calculate the metrics, network metrics we discussed before, to identify hubs and important proteins or transcripts from the network. Another important aspect when we are dealing with biological networks is clustering. And there was the first group of solutions like the Markov clustering or the M-code, which were actually clustering the complete network into clusters, making each protein or transcript to participate in exactly one cluster. And the most widespread used one is the Markov clustering, which is actually starting with a table like this, which shows what is the probability of each one of the proteins to end up starting from each one of the proteins. So from node one, with one step, we can end up in 3, 2, or 1. This is why we have 0.33% probability to reach in 1, 2, or 3. And from 0.3 here, we can end up to 1, 2, 3, or 4. And this is why we have 0.25% probability to end up in 3, 4, in 1, 2, 3, 4, and so on. So this is a starting table. And what the MCL method does is that it raises this table into the power of 2 for a sequence of steps until we end up with a sparse table which tells us which are the clusterings. And here we can see that it ended up with, in the second step, in this format, telling us that there is one cluster composed by 1, 2, and 3, and another cluster composed by 4, 5, and 6. However, the disadvantage of these methods is that they split the complete network to clusters, not taking into consideration the underlying biology, would tell us the protein can participate in from 0 to more than one protein complexes, and it does not participate in only one cluster. This is why there is a new generation of techniques called soft clustering techniques, like the cluster one, which have been developed and suggested to be used to take this into consideration, allowing a protein or a transcript to participate in any one or more than one clusters. And now we're going to go and see and applications of all of these techniques in the analysis of omics data from atherosclerotic plaques, that we have done in our lab. For this specific dataset, we started with from a dataset of samples extracted carotid and atherectomy samples extracted from 121 patients. And for each one of the patients, we have samples from the core and the periphery of the plaque, which we analyzed with a 3-extract strategy to extract for the proteome of the cellular proteome, the core matrison proteome, and the soluble matrison proteome, ending up in the end with 121 multiplied by 2 multiplied by 3, which is equal to 726 samples. And in addition to that, we had targeted proteomics measurements, as well as high-throughput immunoassay measurements to perform validation, making the analysis more complex. But using the pipelines and methods we saw before, the simple bioinformatics pipelines and methods, with this dataset, we ended up expanding significantly the proteome of the carotid plaques compared to the previously biggest study on the field. And this is a first example of analysis that it was conducted using the receptors and receptor binding proteins from the cellular proteome to reconstruct. We reconstructed with using the ARACTINAP pipeline, the co-expression network from our data. And this is the, and we performed cluster one analysis to identify significant clusters. And this is the subnetwork, including the significant clusters here, showing that from our network, we revealed the smooth muscle cell cluster, which is a very important cell type contributing most of the, allotting the ECM proteome of the carotid plaques. Then we found, we differentiated between two macrophage clusters, the leukocyte macrophage cluster here with the C163A protein here, and another monocyte-related pathway with the CD14 and the cathepsins cluster here. We revealed the platelet cluster with major and known platelet markers, and then a neutrophil cluster with the calprotectin complex and MMP9, which are well-known neutrophil markers in the field. And finally, we ended up with a blood coagulation cluster, which is actually a bit complex and needs more analysis to interpret and probably subclustering to get some meaningful information. So in this network, we not only see the clustering, but we also see with the colors on the nodes, the results of the statistics into comparing symptomatic and asymptomatic plaques. So red colors means overexpression in symptomatics, and blue color means overexpression in asymptomatic plaques. So this is a very good example to show us how a network visualization can give us a lot of information from a high throughput dataset. Just from one figure, we can see which are the most significantly changed in proteins, which are the clusters they formulate, and so on. And this annotation of the clusters was conducted with enrichment methods, as we saw before, with just using the David tool. Next, one of the problems we encountered in this study is that because of the very high number of proteins we ended up, which is was in total more than 1,500. When conducting in the discovery study corrections for multiple testing, only a few protein changes were surviving this. In order to alleviate this, we designed a targeted proteomics assay, which actually quantified the proteins that were found to be significant in nominal level in the discovery study. By doing this, we ended up with a smaller set of proteins which were validated. So not only we validated the high throughput technique and how well discovery mass spectrometry quantifies proteins, but we were also able to perform multiple testing corrections in the validation study and get the proteins to be a wide set of proteins to be significant. And we see here just an example of the proteins, the comparison of the proteins in symptomatic and asymptomatic plaques in the validation study. And this is another example about how the information that we found from a network can be used to interpret our biosignatures. And in this case here, we have correlated the revealed biosignature against the first principal component of the clusters that we revealed from the clustering analysis in an attempt to identify which is the most contributing cell type in each for each one of these markers. So you can identify as a validation that the calprotectin part here in the ECM is mostly coming from neutrophils, while serpinates is and other proteins are coming from other types, probably from coagulation, which means that they are circulated and not expressed within this specific tissue type. And this is another example that here we perform PCA analysis using the biosignature we found. And we have performed clustering, K prototypes clustering on this. We revealed four significant clusters from this analysis. In an unbiased way, we searched for from 2 to 20 clusters, and we decided to keep the number of clusters which perform best in using the Kalinsky-Karabas metric from the clustering perspective. And we can see here that this clustering is mostly driven by structural ECM proteins, inflammation signature, as well as the smooth muscle cell content. And we went a step further because for this study, we had the nine-year follow-up of these patients. And we went to see whether any of these clusters is indicative of the composite cardiovascular risk. And we can see that the blue cluster here, which is actually the one showing that it has a highest smooth muscle cell content, it is the one which has the lowest, the highest risk from this analysis. The opposite, this is the cluster that has the smallest smooth muscle content and has the highest risk. So finally, just an example, this is something that you might also be encountering in your studies. We try to validate our findings in an RNA level by using RNA sequencing data to perform the same comparisons and trying to see how the proteins that we found significant at the proteome level change in the comparisons between unstable and stable plaques in the RNA sequencing data and between calcified and non-calcified plaques. And what we can see here is that even if all these proteins are significantly changing in these comparisons in the proteome level, this is not happening in the RNA level. And this is a very common finding. In most of these studies, when we're trying to combine RNA and protein studies, we have less than 30% agreement. And this might come up, might not be a mistake, but it is explained by the underlying biology. A protein level might be related to complex degradation protocols or protein accumulation protocols, while a mechanism, while the RNA is mostly capturing the image of the moment about how the transcripts are expressed from the cell types which are present in the specific tissue type we're examining. So in our specific example here, the biosignature we found from calcification, the majority of it is related to proteins which are not actually expressed in the plaques, but are being accumulated in the plaques because of them being participating in the and being circulatory proteins, circulating proteins in the blood, and retained in the plaques because of calcification and calcification binding mechanism and so on. So this is clear from proteins like SPP1, protein C, phreptoin and calcification, and other calcification inhibitors, which were found not to be actually expressed at all in the plaques, or being very marginally changing in the calcified versus non-calcified plaques. But in the proton level, they were very important. When it comes to inflammation, a lot of validation was found here, and specifically for the macrophage specific markers, which are following the same trend in between RNA and protein, meaning that they are mostly coming from macrophages, which are present in the karyotype plaques. And the same thing happens for the smooth muscle cell biosignature, showing that smooth muscle, the expression of these proteins and transcripts is happening in this specific position of the karyotype plaques. That's all. As a summary, I want to tell you that all these tools are not perfect. They have a lot of problems and a lot of limitations, but they give us a very good starting point to explore our data, identify and prioritize which are the best and most promising changes which we could use to further validate with experiments and to guide us into designing new experiments and new studies. Thank you very much for your attention. If you have any questions, I'd be glad to answer.
Thank you very much, Konstantino. You gave us quite a lot of information. Question for Konstantino?
I have any questions to ask. So why there's feedback? Or something like that, maybe. Okay. Konstantinos, I just wanted to thank you very much for your presentation. I think it's going to be super useful for the students, not only on this call, but as a resource that we can signpost them to as and when they need this kind of thing, because many students, including my own, are moving into bioinformatics and, you know, processing large data sets is something that they're not very familiar with. So I think this is an excellent introductory course. So I just wanted to thank you on that.
Hi, Konstantinos. Thank you very much. That was really interesting. I am sort of following on from that. Thank you. Following on from that, I'm sort of learning to code as I go and sort of learning RNA-seq analysis as I go in R. I just wanted to know if you had any good resources that you could signpost sort of students to, or if you have any lecture material from your lectures and things that are able to be shared, or if we can come along to these things. Because I think, yeah, as Alex says, bioinformatic analysis is something that we're all, especially keen to learn. And I think having somewhere that we could go to would be really helpful.
Yes, what we could do is we have a folder that we, at the moment, we have shared within the lab of Professor Meyer, that I will actually speak with Sylvia to make this accessible to the rest of you of our groups.
In October, we are going to have a couple of people for biomedical engineering introducing Python and giving a practical session about Python. If Konstantino, this is something that you might consider to do similar with R, we will love.
Yes. Sylvia, we can discuss which are the topics that will be covered by the other speakers, and I can do what they do not cover.
Fantastic. So we can have something more around focus on coding.
But Joseph, specifically for the RNA sequencing you asked, actually the Galaxy server have a lot of good materials for pipelines processing RNA sequencing data. So this is a very good starting point for you to start if you are dealing with specific RNA sequencing data analysis questions. What we did today is something that is not specific for an omics data type, and it is specific. It is applicable when you have already done the most of the difficult analysis, which is the pre-processing. But for RNA sequencing, I think you should also revisit the Galaxy repository for as a starting point.
Thank you.
Are there any other questions for Konstantinos? There is a question from Richard Beth.
Hi, Konstantinos. Yeah, thank you. That was really interesting. Yeah, very useful. I'm sure all the students will get a lot out of that, if particularly if there are signposts and resources that could be made available to everyone. I just had a question which was a little bit more specific, I suppose, or at least philosophical. In when you were talking about network diagrams and you were talking about directionality, am I right in assuming that the information regarding the directionality of network diagrams comes from, not from the data set itself, but from the information that's mined from the literature and put into the databases by the people that enter all the gene ontology information into the networks, so it's not within the data set itself. So if you have a simple data set, which is, say, control versus treatment, and you have two proteins that interact or two genes that interact, now that directionality comes from information that's in the literature base rather than from the data itself.
Yes, thank you for the question. So this is very important. What we use from databases, from the literature and network, we reconstruct from them are informative, but they are not 100% applicable in our case. So what we have seen in our from our experience and from exploring proteomics data mostly is that the majority of the interactions included in databases are not happening in every one of the tissues types we're examining. So they might happen in plaques, in the carotid, and they might not happen in the coronary artery, or they might happen in liver and not in heart. So it's very important to be able to reconstruct them from our own data and then validate them from the database, and not the vice versa. Reconstructing from the databases is not the first step. Someone should reconstruct the correlation network from his own network, the data, and then go and see the agreement or the new elements he found from compared databases. But again, this is not conclusive of mechanism, and it cannot be conclusive analysis. This is just a starting point of identifying significant edges, which should then be validated with experimental techniques, cross-linking experiments, things like that. It's very difficult. We do this fancy analysis most of the time, but we should have a biological question in the back of our head all the time to answer. Not do this analysis just to have fancy figures, but also have a plan how we can validate them and follow up what we identify as significant.
Yeah, that's a great answer. Yeah, because I was just wondering, you know, if the literature contains mostly information about protein interactions from cancer cells, for instance, and you're trying to apply that to the carotid,
this is exactly the case. The majority of the interactions now are coming from experiments to cancer studies, because this is where this high throughput omics analysis were first done, and this is the most of our evidence. And they do not, and in our case, where we're dealing with cardiovascular, multi-omics analysis and this high-throughput analysis in cardiovascular research is very widespread in the last 10 years, but it doesn't have a history of 30 years as it has for cancer, for example. So we have to be very cautious, and in our case, because we're examining, for example, new cell types, differentiated cell types, what interactions have been found in other cells and in other tissues will not be applicable in our cases, in most of the cases.
Great, thank you.
Thank you, Konstantinos. Is there any other question? No, I think we exhausted all the questions. Thank you very much for today. And